All right, let's learn something.
Hey, what's going on? So lately I've been getting a lot of questions of how my patch bay is actually set up. And that question to me strikes me as, how do patch bays actually work? Because there's not that many ways to set them up, but there are a lot of different uses for them. So I have an extra patch bay where we can kind of see the inside internal routings of it, sorta, not really, but hopefully that will help you understand a bit more about how patch bays work. I've also gone through some really embarrassing, I have no idea what I'm doing. I mean, I still have no idea what I'm doing. Moments with patch bays and how I set them up. So maybe you can learn from those and avoid doing those things because they're so funny to think about now. But in the learning process when you don't have anybody, oh well, whatever works, works, right? So yeah, let's head to the bench and check it out. Okay, patch bays. So they come in a bunch of different amounts of inputs, types of inputs, outputs, all that stuff. I normally stick with the typical quarter ones, the quarter inch ones, I should say. You can get balanced, unbalanced. You can get half normal, normal. I'll try and cover some of these different things, but for the most part, you want a typical normal or half normal patch bay. Most of them are that. It's pretty rare that you would accidentally maybe buy one that isn't. One that's really good is one by a company called Samsung. They have one, it's about 90 to 100 bucks, which is pretty expensive. I don't own it yet. I really want to buy one once I save up and stop buying random garbage and start kind of getting serious, I guess I'll do that. This one here, I mean, you can tell it looks like it was found at the bottom of an ocean. It's pretty beat up, it's pretty gross, and yeah, they can get ground noises and stuff like that. This one's a 20 point patch bay, or 40 point. They normally count it by each individual thing. So yeah, like I said before, I've had some embarrassing, do not use your patch bays this way. For example, the first thing, if we take a look at mistake number one, using masking tape, just buy board tape. Mistake number two, putting tape on top of this. When this is racked up into a shelf, you cannot see the top of this. And the biggest, I guess, least embarrassing, but still pretty embarrassing thing, at least for me, was thinking that the way you route this, let's say we have left and right of one synthesizer, would be to go left and right. Left, right, left, right, left, right. Because I looked at this and you can see that the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are right here. So I was like, oh yeah, input one, input two, like, or synth one, synth two. I was thinking of it from just a synthesizer person point of view, I guess, and that's not what you're supposed to do. Basically, the way a patch bay works, so if I put it like this, you have these cards, and if we take a look at this side, you can see here that you have these little black chips, right, or these sockets. All that is just the inputs and the outputs. But the way a patch bay works is when you plug something into the back, this top one here, the back top, that's going to be the output of something, the output of a synthesizer, something that is producing sound. Then the back bottom is going to be wanting to receive that sound. So this would be the inputs of an audio interface or a sampler or what have you, a recorder. So let's pretend that this here is, I don't know, a 2i2 or an interface, an Apollo, a Duet, whatever you want to call it. And we're just going to go into input number one of our audio interface. If I'm setting this up as if it's going to be permanently installed in my studio, I would then go into input number one. Of course, here's the other thing. This is probably confusing to you because this isn't input number one. You can see it says input 20 right there. So technically, should I do this? This is so sketchy. This is going to fall. Technically, it would go here. So let's just focus in on one channel, then we can take it from there. So that is going to our audio interface. Now, let's say we always use the model cycles. I want this permanently installed in my studio. So I would run the output of this through the back of my desk or whatever and into the top of this patch bay. And without further ado, yep, we got sound. Of course, it's just on the left. We're running mono right now. And again, nothing there. You just hear a ground noise. See this thing? They can get really crazy sounding. So cool. That's how a patch bay works. All right, Peace. No, I'm kidding. There's a bunch of different other ways you can use this. So you might be wondering, Enrique, why don't you just go from here into here? Well, if I wanted to incorporate anything else within the signal chain, let's say some effects, I would then need to unplug this from here, or I would plug into here and then go out of here into here and just kind of ruin a couple things, because depending on how long the cables are, where they're routed, and then going back into my audio interface can be a big pain, especially when you have audio interfaces like mine, which is the 8Pre-X or the Sapphire Octopre Dynamic. All their inputs are on the back, so it becomes a pain to have to constantly go to the back, unplug stuff, crawl around with a flashlight, figure where things are, and then try to bring it back to life, I guess. So having a patch bay just gives you a quick access to the front, using the front to any input. So watch, check this. We're playing this. And the other thing to note is the patch bays can be normaled or half normaled. And I believe this is half normaled, because if I were to plug in on the top, nothing happens. We still hear the signal. But if I were to plug into the bottom, it breaks the normalization. And what normalization is, essentially, and the easiest way to understand it, is something that automatically happens. Something automatically goes somewhere, or something is always by default routed somewhere. So in the terms of patch bays, the back top patch point is always routed to the back bottom patch point. It's just normal. That's the way it'll always be, unless you take these cards out and flip them around, or flip some switches on the front of a patch bay, if your patch bay has that, like that Samsung one. So check this out. Let's say I did want to break that half normalization. You plug something into the front. It's gone. But if I wanted to send this signal somewhere, the top, which is our output of our synthesizer, is now going out into this signal, into this cable, and back into here, until, let's say we have this, pyramids. We'll go into pyramids. We still don't hear any change. But if I grab this gray cable, go into here, and then we plug into the front of this little signal here, or this patch bay here, we're now hearing this version. Cool, right? So we didn't have to do much besides just pulling this in the front. If I unplug this, we're back to our normal signal. So where patch bays come into handy even more is, check this. Let's say I just bought something new, like an Avalon bassline. And man, this is getting too crowded. Okay, so say we have the Avalon bassline here. Oh my gosh, something's gonna break for sure. I can go out of the Avalon bassline and just plug straight into the bottom. We hear nothing now. This is no longer being played, and we have access to an Avalon bassline. And the reason this is great is because I didn't have to go and unplug model cycles out of the audio interface, plug this in, run another long cable, run to the back of my thing. It's just so fast and so easy to just reroute and change up whatever you want, whenever you want. And there's still one more thing that's really, really cool. So let's say we still did want to hear this, and we had a bunch of other things going on in our signal path. If this blue cable was input number two. Oh man, something's gonna break for sure. I'm so nervous right now. Okay, so say this blue cable is input number two. Actually, you know what? For the sake of clarity, let's plug it in all the way down here. Input number two, and I still wanted to listen to the model cycles. I can just go out of the top of the model cycles input, which is this one here, and just go into this channel right here. And you can hear that comes in on our right ear. So now we still have access to this and this at the same time. We didn't add any signals or anything like that. All we did was we decided to use the Avalon, and then you know what? We actually still wanted to use the model cycles again. Let's just send it somewhere else into another one of our free inputs of our audio interface, which are all connected to the bottom. So when you get new gear or whatever, you can just quickly have access to your inputs. That's the greatest reason and the biggest reason why I love patchbays, as well as being able to quickly plug in any kind of effects pedals or guitar pedals or samplers. So for example, on my MPC, which is a sampler, anytime on the back, let me just unplug this really quick. On the back of my MPC, or on the back of my patchbay, the top four in the corner of my patchbay now are all outputs that are exactly the same as what my monitors are playing back. This allows me to quickly sample and grab samples from anything in my studio, as long as I plug the front of this into my MPC, because it's just automatically normaled. I can go from my studio out of the audio interface outputs 3, 4, 5, 6 or whatever, boom, boom, and just plug this straight into my MPC, and I got signal to sample whatever. And there's still one more thing, and this is what Once Upon a Time really, like, you know, blew me away when he did this, and I use this all the time now. So check this out. This is my favorite thing. Okay, with the pyramids back, this is what blew me away the most. Again, Once Upon a Synth, thank you for completely opening up my eyes as to how I can further utilize gear I already had. So this is input one, the orange. And input number two, let's just pretend this is an audio interface, is right here. If we go out of model cycles into here, and then I take this and plug it into the top, we've effectively just split that same signal, and now it's coming into this cable. So if I were to go into here and go out of here, I can then check this out. Boom, I'm recording the affected signal on channel 2, and I'm recording the dry signal on channel 1. This gives me quick, easy access to just multi-tracking effects. But the other thing to note here is I didn't somehow magically add any inputs to my signal chain or anything. These are inputs that I already had available on my audio interface. If you're only limited to 2 channels or something like that, you will always only have 2 channels to record into. So this ultimately will take up another channel to record, but that's just physics, I guess. I don't know what to call it. I mean, that's just the way it works. So being able to quickly have access to your audio inputs, your audio interface's inputs right from the front of something like this is so handy. And not only that, you have quick access to the output of the synthesizers that you normally have set up in your place that you normally use and that you want installed permanently. So with that being said, quick recap, your synthesizer audio outputs always go into the top of the patch bay, right? Audio outputs, anything sending sound out is going into the top. Anything waiting to receive that sound and accept that sound, the inputs of your interfaces or your samplers or whatever, go into the bottom. That's why they call it the waterfall. It goes in and the water falls down and comes back out. And until you plug something into the front, it will break that normalization or that waterfall. But outputs, inputs, it takes a second to get used to it. I'm still trying to fully wrap my head around it. And this is years down the line of messing around with patch bays and stuff. Just don't do what I did where I went left and right. This is how silly what I was doing was. So let's say I want to record we all start somewhere. So this is my signal chain. This was input 1, input 2, input 3, input 4, input 5, input 6. What? Why would I ever even need a patch bay then? So then in order to record this, I would go 1, and then I would have to go like this and record 2. What the heck is this mess? This makes no sense at all. But again, there are a million ways you can route this thing. This is definitely not one. Don't do it like this. If you're doing recording left and right of your synthesizers, it would be set up like this. You would go left and right, again into inputs 1 and 2. 1, 2, left, right, 1, 2. And that's how your signal would work into your audio interface. And then of course, if you're going stereo into effects and all that stuff on the back. So yeah, I hope you learned something from this. Again, I have a link down to Once Upon a Synth video on Patchbay down below. Incredibly smart, awesome person. Thank you again for making that video. I really appreciate it for teaching me and hopefully being able to pass on some information to you. So go tell him I said what's up. And yeah, thanks again for kicking it. It's always good to see you, and I hope to see you again next week. You already know the drill. Share the love, share the knowledge. Knowledge is power. Peace. What is this? Nah, we ain't gotta listen to that cheesy song. I'm out.